Arseni, we're back for the second show, and I'm again here with my wonderful crew. We've got Dan, Rob, we've got beautiful Patrick, and we've got Rob Stutzman, and I'm your host, Katrina Arseni. Today, we're going to be covering some of the propositions that have to do with healthcare in California, also labor. And right after that, we're going to get into some entertaining segments, just like we did last time, because, you know, they were so much fun, right, guys?
We're so fun.
Yes. So going right into it, we've got a couple of guest segments with some really interesting dialogue. First and foremost, I want to dive into the first one that has to do with a baseball player who is now an activist in a very important space, healthcare, mental health, and eating disorders. He's the first one to take on the stigma when it comes to men and eating disorders. So we'll dive right in. And first and foremost, we are here in Sacramento at the Diplomat, and we want to actually acknowledge the Diplomat for being our home base. Thank you guys all. Let's give a round of applause. The Diplomat, you want to check him out in Sacramento when you're in town. So we've got Michael Marjama, Mariners baseball player, excited that he's here on our show. And I want to dive right in and introduce him and tell us a little bit about your baseball career, as well as why are you an activist? Why in the space? What's going on with legislation in the space that you're so excited about?
Yeah, well, thank you guys for having me. It's an honor to be here with you guys. So I retired in July. I've been playing the past 2 years in the big leagues with the Seattle Mariners. Got to start opening day this year, catching Felix Hernandez in front of 50,000 people, facing Corey Kluber and the Indians. And, you know, for me, it was one of the highlights of my career and something that I always look forward to. But not many people look into the backstory and what has happened in my life before that. And for me, I grew up here in Granite Bay, California, born and raised here, getting my diapers changed underneath the seats at Arco Arena. And,
woo!
And,
just like Dan.
Yes!
Last week.
Home opener.
Home opener.
TMI.
Yeah, but it's been, it's amazing. So I was born and raised here. My dad and my uncle, I've got a lot of family here that had local businesses. And for me now to have my platform as a Major League Baseball player and giving back to the community here is something I really, you know, really look forward to doing every year. And and now being able to do it in a different way, having a Major League platform, is something huge. And for me, it was started in junior high school, and I ended up having an eating disorder, which I sought treatment for my junior year of high school. Just kind of one step along the way in overcoming some obstacles with, you know, the depression, anxieties, things that we notice now that a lot of athletes face, both men and women. You know, they don't discriminate. They don't discriminate on age, ethnicity, gender. You know, a lot of the factors that we think that you know, only certain people deal with issues. And so I've got an opportunity to work with LeBron James and his media company, which is called Uninterrupted. We shot a documentary, and that's come out. So I've been able to appear on Good Morning America, The Doctors, CBS News. I mean, I've been pretty much
SacTown
everywhere. SacTown5 now. So
All about California.
Yeah, so it's great. And now it's an opportunity to continue to spread the message and really help not only men, but really everyone who we all have problems. We all suffer at some point in our life, and it's how we can make that going forward.
And you know what? That's all tied into the really important space of mental health. It's something that is a taboo topic. You mentioned stigma, and interestingly enough, right now for the first time we have so many propositions that have to do with mental health in the space of, you know, November 6th elections. I know you always say rent control, but mental health is a big component of it as well, coming up in November, right, Dan?
Yeah, I mean, so your career retirement coincided with the end of the Giants season this year, right? So
pretty much.
Okay. Yeah,
pretty much. So,
but, we're gonna make this
but as a male, talk to me about the stigma of trying to be a professional ball player, and dealing with an issue that is traditionally something that a lot of guys don't want to talk about. We don't talk about our health. We don't talk about, we're not, you know, we're macho men. How difficult was that for you to deal with? And were you able to be public when it happened?
Yeah, and I think it's something that's, you know, we're always like, we can't ask for directions. What makes you think we're going to tell you something that's going on inside our head, right? But I mean, as men, we have problems too. It's not like we just roll out of bed and we're like, oh, we're guys, like everything's good. And I think that's for everybody. We all have something. We don't, whether it's we turn to substance abuse, we know that alcoholism is another way to go. We have areas of addressing our issues, but are we choosing a healthy way or are we choosing an unhealthy way?
Especially with social media too, right? It's such a, I mean, I look at that now and I feel so bad for these kids these days. They now have that aspect to deal with too. Social media is becoming a problem with some of these kids and having to compare and competition and bullying. But, you know, that was the era that I didn't have to deal with. And I look at that now and we're talking about stigmas. I mean, you being a pioneer in the space for men and representing it, good for you. What's happening when it comes to legislation across, I mean, right behind us, what's going on in California when it comes to mental health and eating disorders? What are you doing in that space right now?
Yeah, so I'm actually an ambassador for the National Eating Disorder Association. So I travel around the country pretty much every week, being able to speak at colleges and really with different treatment centers and locations. I actually got a few weeks ago, got to go to DC to do a congressional briefing. And I think it's one of the areas we're looking at is populations that you wouldn't expect. We think of an eating disorder, we think of mental illness, we think of a really emaciated Caucasian female. But we know that they're not. We see the stats, and we know that 30 million Americans are suffering from an eating disorder. And we know that there's 20 million women, 10 million men. And I know those numbers are off because I have men that reach out to me on social media, like you said, and they're like, hey, I've had this for 20, 30 years. I've never been able to tell anybody. Mm-hmm. Well, I wonder why, because you're going to be looked at differently. So it's men being able to come out and say it's okay. So we looked into populations, the men. We look into overweight populations, obesity prevention. We look at when you go into a doctor's office, you step on a scale and automatically they take your weight and BMI. Well, I can show you a girl that looks, or a male that looks extremely healthy, and they look that way, but they have multiple organ failure going on.
Wow.
So really, does weight actually dictate health?
Right.
And in my opinion, it doesn't. So we look at those populations. One in four people that are overweight or dealing with obesity have an underlying binge eating disorder.
And you and I have talked about this, actually, and especially with the women, too. You know, everybody's looking at, you know, how do I get on that next best diet and lose weight and so forth and so on. But at the end of the day, is skinny really healthy? That's the question that,
we're putting together a program. Yeah. We've had one. It's called the Body Project. It's out of University of California, San Diego. So USD put this program together. It's been 20 years of research backing. It's called the Body Project.
Mm-hmm.
And that's largely been on females. So actually, out of California, or out of Sacramento here, out of Granite Bay High School, we've got a few other schools in the area that are pilot testing our program, which will be for young men.
Wow.
So all that stuff will be coming out of here, out of Sacramento, out of this area.
I'm so
glad
we'll to
be
hear that.
Coming out of really this great city, my hometown,
right.
And being able to be disseminated across the country.
And that's so why we're doing this show.
And how prevalent is it with special athletes?
Right?
All the time. So they're saying that over, you know, it's really about 60 to 70% of, especially females in athletics, have traits of eating disorders.
Wow.
And so we know that it's not only in that, it's in men as well. Men feel the same stereotypes, right? If we don't look like the Spartans from 300, they're somehow at a disadvantage, right? And it's like, well, that's not the case.
Rob's
not everyone could be like Rob.
I mean,
that
was the Spartans from 100.
Exactly.
Make it to the screen.
Michael, real quickly.
Yeah. Yes.
With young men and men, what does it look like? What does the eating disorders look like?
Yeah. So let me tell you something. So we notice this, that within men and even within women, is I look like a normal kid, but I was riding on a stationary bike in a shower with the steam going till I'd pass out.
Wow.
I was the guy putting on, you know, strapping trash bags. I'd have two almonds. At Thanksgiving dinner, I had two almonds and three carrots on my plate because I was told that the Atkins diet was big back then and carbs are the enemy. So I wasn't going to have anything. And I was, well, you need to go work out. And it was like, well, great. So if I work out a bunch and I don't eat anything, I won't get fat and I'll just get big and strong. How many messages are that for us as men is like, don't worry about your issues. Just subdue them. Just push through it.
Yeah.
But we don't know what is healthy. We don't know what that is. So it's great having the legislation and pieces we can put in place and
absolutely.
Say, this is what can be done. These are healthy ways of coping, and this is how we can teach that.
Well, they're lucky to have you as an
absolutely.
Activist ambassador. You're, you know, an inspiration. Thanks for being here. Impact influencer. That's why we wanted you on the show. So thanks for your time. Now, on that same note, one of the things that I actually want to do is, as you guys know, last time we played, we had our mayor here. This time we're going to actually play again, and we're going to play Patrick.
Creeper or keeper.
That's right. So we got the creeper or keeper, and listen, I mean, we got even music going with that. So Michael, I know you haven't participated
wait,
in this.
Creep?
No, not that you.
Oh,
not
okay.
You.
I was like,
to
say, I was like, whoa.
No, we're all going to go around
him.
And judge you.
No.
Jeez.
We've got.
Just to make the point.
We've got an entertaining portion. And we want to actually do this creeper keeper. And the idea is Patrick picks someone this week. Or some ones. I think you have a few.
Yeah, we've got multiple.
They have, characters.
It'll be interesting to see what the panel thinks about these two, if they are a creeper or a keeper.
And the idea here is we all vote, and at the end of the day, we find out who's the winner. Are they a creeper or are they a keeper? So first and foremost, let's go with your
all
first
pick. So I love that we're talking about weight because I want to introduce everyone to the hottest thing on the internet, right? Meow.
Meow.
I'm talking, of course, about Bruno, the 25-pound cat. who sits upright.
It's like a marshal.
As though he's a person. Let me tell you something about this
cat. He's
got
a good posture, I have to say.
Bruno was born with an extra appendage.
What?
Which has made him, to some people, seem unadoptable at the Illinois shelter where he currently stays.
I'm going to sneeze.
I say that this is so adorable. Look at Bruno.
Kitty.
This 25-pound fur ball of love.
So it says that he was homeless until he became like an internet star. Is that a social media thing?
Yeah, so he was sort of a stray cat that, you know, people would walk by and
kinda
say.
Like Dan.
Who was this?
Yeah.
I'm like, put him in the car.
He roams around the Capitol all the time, so, you know.
Put him in the car, have him ride shotgun when you roll through Taco Bell. Right?
Hopefully there's no extra appendage.
We do have a lot of hair, so that is it,
The good news is there was a happy ending for Bruno. He did get adopted by a loving
family. He's a keeper!
But what do we think, panel?
Keeper. What do you think?
Yeah, former teammate of mine, Matt Duffy, has a cat that is plus size.
Cat?
It's a keeper for me.
Aww.
Yes.
Cookie point. What do you think?
I've got complete creeper.
No.
You know what? That cat needs to learn how to sit down like a real cat. And we have enough fat cats in this city.
Be nice. What
Look
do you think?
That.
Dan.
I'm just not a cat guy.
Okay, nobody's asking you anything anymore. Okay. Winner, I say it's a keeper.
Keeper.
Okay, but we do have a second one.
And so moving on. You know, Senator Lindsey Graham, who is fresh off
creeper.
Being the chairman.
Hold on, let's turn it too soon?
Look, it's too, okay, sorry.
Give him a chance to tell
the story. Senator Graham is fresh off being the champion for Kavanaugh that nobody wanted.
Right.
Well, that's not true.
Is back making headlines lately for a recent Fox and Friends interview he gave where they were discussing Senator Elizabeth Warren's comments that she was Native American. Well, Senator Graham chimed in saying, I hope they don't test my DNA because it would probably determine, and I quote, that I'm Iranian, which would be like terrible.
Oh, hello.
Pretty controversial statement made by a senator who's already garnering a lot of headlines.
That's anti-Jewish.
Right.
Because Iranians are my people.
So let's hear what we think.
And you know what? Like, it worked really well for me because I am half Iranian and very proud. So, creeper. All the way. Thank you so much.
Scumbag.
Well, Lindsay, this is why politicians shouldn't do live television.
Absolutely.
Complete creeper. So, and I like the cat now.
Now I like you too.
All right.
Okay, and on that note, thank you, Patrick.
Of course.
Thank you for being on the show. Appreciate your participation and support, and keep doing what you're doing.
Good for you. Thanks.
We're going to wrap up to a break to thank our sponsors once again, The Diplomat and many others who've been big supporters here in Sacramento, California. We'll be right back. Stay tuned for the next segment where we're going to get into propositions that are going to be on the ballot November 6th. So make sure you vote